Hello, I'm Fantastic and Fantastic, and today I'm going to be talking about the Demon Slayer collab that has gone live in North America. So, the Demon Slayer collab is one of the more highly anticipated events to come to us, but it has a few drawbacks. The most notable drawback is the exceptionally long delay between the JP release and our release. So, a little bit of a backstory of how cards work in PAD. A card can never actually be nerfed, but instead, as newer cards are released, they become weaker, relatively speaking, compared to the newer options now available. So, if a card is released, say, many months later, they tend to fall behind, so to speak. So many of these cards may feel a little dated. We did receive a small leader skill buff for various cards, but at the same time, it may not necessarily be enough to push some of these to the threshold or level that we would want them to be at. With that being said, this is a new event, which means all the cards you roll will be new, and new cards oftentimes have more value compared to, or like, will provide different kinds of value or plug holes in your monster backs that you could not have necessarily addressed otherwise. And in the case of the Demon Slayer event, the 7 and 8 star cards are tremendously strong. They have many unique aspects to them, and it can be quite difficult to replicate them. So, it is still definitely an event worth rolling in because you have the chance of basically striking gold, so to speak. And at least for your first several rolls, at least the chance of duplicates should be a little lower. Another drawback with this type of Rare Machine collab is that it costs 7 magic stones, which means from the 8-star, 7-star, and 6-star rarities, you cannot monster exchange for the 7 stars. You actually have to roll them. And that's going to be quite difficult because the odds are not in your favor. 70% of the cards will be the bottom rarity. And 70% is not the worst when it comes to collabs, but from the bottom rarity, I only feel that one of them is truly great, and it's only great if you have 4 copies of it. So it is definitely a problematic event in that sense because it is definitely incredibly top heavy. It's going to be very unfun to roll because there's no pity system, and most of the time you're going to result in lots of sadness. On the bright side, Gung Ho will be gifting every player a free 8-star card at random, which will happen at a date in the future. I don't know when it is, so asking me won't actually accomplish anything. So, without further ado, I would like to just take a look at all of the cards found in this event to give you a better idea of how they can be utilized and to give you more possible motivation of rolling or maybe not necessarily rolling if you feel like you can't advance your monster box. So, the first 8-star card in this event is Tanjiro, and this individual here is a strong card overall. They are still a tremendously powerful leader, and they did receive a buff to have higher amounts of health and recovery, which means they are bulkier, which makes it easier to actually hit the health thresholds necessary to survive Dangerous Mechanics in World of Carnage 2. Once they do transform, they are a tremendous damage solution. They have a VDP, 777 combo, a Devil Killer Awakening, along with a wonderfully high attack stat. So high amounts of personal damage. They also have one of the strongest or overtuned active skills in the game, I feel. It's a 2-turn cooldown that makes 4 fire orbs and provides an RCV buff and an attacker buff. So you're able to overwrite any existing debuff while also giving yourself higher uptime in terms of your multipliers. So if you are utilizing them as a leader, which is still strong, you can multiply the attack and the RCV component by 1.5 times to create a new effective leader skill because you're going to be using their active skill every single turn of the same amount of health, 4.84 times, 486 times attack, and 7.26 times recovery. So healing should always be quite straightforward. You can probably restore yourself to full health every single turn, and you're also overriding any existing debuff. They can definitely be utilized as a sub or leader. So for their leadership potential, I'll focus on that first. They have to use attacker type or water attribute cards. That is definitely problematic. It does hinder their ability to draw upon some of the more tasty subs, so to speak, but there are still options available. Once you populate your team with the appropriate cards, you gain damage reduction when matching 4 or more connected fire orbs, and their active skill generates 4. So as a leader, you have an active skill every single turn, which means as long as the board wasn't locked to begin with, you can always trigger your damage reduction. But at the same time, 4.84 times health is a tremendous amount. You can probably withstand large amounts of punishment, and you may not necessarily need the damage reduction every single turn, but you're probably always going to have it anyways. And in addition to that, when you match four or more connected fire orbs, which again, you do all the time, you get plus six combos with dual leaders. So one combo becomes seven. In terms of how brainless this leader is, it's one of the more brainless leaders available that can do tremendously, that can tackle tremendously hard content. Amazing leadership potential all around, but I do want to stress the fact that they have hindrance by being restricted to attacker types, and in World of Carnage 2, or Alt World of Carnage 2, I should say, Sun Quan is an incredibly challenging spawn because your team is full of attackers. Sun Quan is water to start and reduces damage by attackers by 50%, which in turn means you are only dealing 25 or one quarter of your regular damage on top of their 90% damage reduction shield, and you have to push them below half health within 3 turns or you die. It's a big roadblock stopping point because your whole team is heavily disadvantaged. It's definitely going to be a problematic aspect. But if you want to use them as a sub, it opens up other possibilities. You do have to be mindful of the fact that they don't provide skill boosts, so they won't be helping you transform. And the guard break is probably going to be useless on the vast majority of your teams because you're just not necessarily going to have those colors all available, so that definitely can be problematic, at least for current based content. But as a sub, they definitely can find a home on Sena teams. On Sena teams, they can act as a replacement for Grandis as long as you can absorb the loss of two skill boosts. And with that, you have a regular access to attack and RCV buffs, which are kind of difficult to incorporate on your Sena teams. I had to do quite a bit of juggling to incorporate an RCV buff on my team, and it was kind of frustrating. Grandis solves the attack buff, but you could trade Grandis for this individual here, and you have access to that RCV buff, which is going to make many of the spawns much more doable. So it definitely opens up that possibility. And if you have a sub like, say, Horus, you are going to be able to have a movement time buff on a regular basis. You can overcome the vast majority of debuffs with relative ease. So as a sub or as a leader, they are definitely tremendously strong. It does definitely open up endgame dungeons for players. For their weapon assist, it gives you a skill boost and a skill bind resist, which is the exact same as the farmable Riku, but that can be problematic. But I guess the movement time can provide extra value. And their active skill is strong, but it is on a longer cooldown. This active provides you with 3 turns of movement time, RCV, and attack buff, along with bonus combos. It does a bunch of everything, but the problem is you cannot rely on this weapon assist to overwrite numerous repeated debuffs. You're just not going to be able to charge up a 15 turn cooldown on a frequent basis. It's great when you need to overcome multiple problems at the same time, but for repeated use, it's not going to be that great. And at the same time, the opportunity cost of not using this weapon is quite high because their transforming form is still a tremendously strong leader and a sub. For the next 7-star card, Muzan has an incredibly unique and powerful base form. In their base form, they have one of the most brain-dead leader skills you can possibly conceive. If you're above 50% health, you receive all the following benefits with dual leaders: 400 times attack, 75% damage reduction, healing 20 times the RCV of your leaders when matching orbs. So you can ignore those RCV penalties, or if your RCV gets debuffed, whatever, you still auto-heal. It's an interesting aspect. And none of this has any matching requirement. None of this has a typing requirement or color requirement. You can use any card you want, match one combo with any element, and you get all these benefits. Even if you match zero combos, you still get your damage reduction as long as your health is above 50%. So in terms of brainlessness, unbelievable, like super, super easy to use. And as long as you don't dip below 50% health, you are incredibly powerful. Their active skill also generates 2 rows of dark orbs, which will help you deal more damage. And the main application for this individual here is to abuse them for either ranking dungeons, blitzing through easy to medium difficulty content because you just have huge amounts of damage with no effort, or to repeatedly play a dungeon over and over again in the hopes of farming it for valuable drops, because again, it's relatively straightforward and easy to do. In addition to that, you have some attack well above 80%, which does improve their offensive prowess, along with the fact they have high base attack. And because they are a sub attribute only card, they're the last hit that does occur. And with the combo orb awakenings, they're allowed to actually utilize the damage absorb latent, which means you don't necessarily have to bring a Fujin style active skill if this latent is on your friend, because the friend will be the final hit, and the final hit will deal its full damage because it cancels out the damage absorb and they have high amounts of personal damage. So it can become one of the most magical farming options possibly available, or ranking dungeon solutions. And this is, of course, a somewhat narrower usage in a sense, but at the same time, you're one of the best at this, which makes them tremendously valuable in this form. By comparison, their evolved form is a strong rainbow leader. It's still strong, it still has merits, it's very similar to Valentine's Ideal. So you can imagine all the pros and cons of Valentine's Ideal of having big bulk, solid damage, bonus combos, and no skyfalls. But the problem is, I feel rainbow-based teams are lacking compared to Monocolor. Monocolor has access to enhanced combo orbs, which just skyrockets your damage output. Monocolor can also use orb changers to make more of your important color. So damage becomes much easier, whereas rainbow teams will struggle to deal large amounts of damage on a regular basis because you can't concentrate your damage. So it's not to say that she is a, or they are a weak leader by any means. It's just that their base form is more unique in what it can accomplish. It's going to be difficult to outpace their potential for speed clearing stuff, and that's just going to give them much more staying power as opposed to evolved form, which is strong, I'd say, right now, but it's going to decline over time. Like, Valentine's Ideal has definitely fallen out of favor by compare, like, as well, and the same thing can be basically applied to this individual here. Next is their weapon assist. So their weapon assist provides 4 dark rows, which definitely can help with adding bonus damage and an attack roll above 80%, which in turn gives plus 1.5 times attack for the owning card. And this weapon assist has magical synergy with their base form, because their base form is always going to be at 80% or more health on a regular basis, I would say. The problem is, if you are not relying on being high health, which is really on their own teams, which means you need a duplicate, this weapon assist becomes kind of moot, in the sense that most mono dark teams are relying on attack well below 50%, so this offensive awakening doesn't do any good. And if you need it rose, Eris Apple or Chuan are farmable solutions that also produce dark orbs. This weapon does not generate dark orbs. The other options do. So having a steady flow of dark orbs is important when you're farming through content or playing through content as quickly as possible. This weapon doesn't provide it. So the only truly beneficial place I could foresee it being used is on their base form, but again, that needs duplicates, which is not going to be doable for the average player. Next is the last 8-star individual whose name I can't pronounce and I'm not going to try, but in their base form, they have strong VDP damage against devils, but VDP damage is inconsistent. They don't do damage without VDP. It's honestly better just to look at their evolved or weapon assist form. In their evolved form, they're able to function as a strong mono fire cleric option because they have solid personal damage, especially against devil type spawns. They can gain a super blind resist, and they do have the ability to clear 5 turns of bind, awoken bind, unable to match or effects, while also generating a row of fire orbs. So it's going to have at least one useful component no matter when you use this active skill, which is definitely meaningful. But the biggest problem is there is so much competition for strong fire clerics, because we have Nezuko and Christmas Grimory, who are both superior options by comparison. The only true advantage this card has over them is the fact that they have a higher health stat compared to Christmas Grimory. But Christmas Grimory is still pretty close as well, and Christmas Grimory also gets access to more latent slots, which is another big bonus in itself. And the 2 skill boosts definitely hurts their capacity, because clerics oftentimes provide more utility, and this individual here is definitely lighter on utility, more on offense, but Nezuko is better for offense and more utility. So it's just weird. You're kind of in a weird, awkward place. You are good, but you're inferior compared to 2 other options, especially 1 other option that's already available in this event. For their weapon assist, it provides you with a skill boost, attack wall above 80%, and a couple of enhanced fire orbs, along with a unique active skill that scales the damage based off of the number of VDP awakenings. So you have the potential to add a large amount of an attack buff, but it's going to be wildly inconsistent, so it might end up being just used for a small attack buff and 9 fire orbs being generated. Not a terrible thing, but again, not the most magical weapon assist out there. Like, attack wall above 80% is a very narrow window for success. Not too many teams can really take advantage of it, I feel, overall. And skill boost is nice, but this is still not the greatest weapon assist overall. So if you do have only 1 copy of this card here, I would pursue their evolved form, especially if you don't have Nezuko or Christmas Grimory, because it's going to be possibly your next best fire cleric option. And speaking of Nezuko, Nezuko is the first 7-star card to be featured, and they are one of the strongest mono fire subs in the game. In their base form, they have 3 skill boosts and a 2-turn haste upon transformation, which means there are 5 effective skill boosts, which will greatly increase the chances of you transforming with relative ease. And then once they are transformed, they deal spectacular amounts of damage. They have double 7 combo, double VDP, and an L Awakening. So you have that utility with the L to unlock the board. You have meaningful personal damage, especially when you match a VDP. You have Cloud Resist, you have Skillbind Resist, which is useful to have because some cards seem to be missing it, and you have a highly powerful active skill. You clear 7 turns of bind, awoken bind, and unable to match orb effects, and then 2 turns of 20% maximum health heal. The healing aspect is probably not going to play that big a role, but the cleric aspect is meaningful. It's on a 4-turn cooldown, which means you can inherit something over top of it if that's necessary. And the only true drawback of them is that in their base form, they are vulnerable to bind, so you probably need to use a bind immune weapon if you're playing through, say, like World of Carnage 2, where things preemptively bind you. And the other drawback is heavy overlap with Christmas Gremory. So to compare the two, Nezuko has 1 more skill boost, significantly more personal damage, and a faster charging active skill. Christmas Gremory offers super jammer resist, follow-up attack, orb generation, about 2,000 more health, and passive damage for the entire team. So, between the two, I think both are tremendously strong and valuable, and what you would choose to use will depend on the dungeon you are playing through, and what aspects you need. Another thing I forgot to mention is Nezuko does have that L, which can sometimes be difficult to incorporate on your mono fire team, so that again opens up more possibilities. So, if you have both of them, fantastic, because now you can choose the best one for a given situation. But I want to stress that both Christmas Gremory and Nezuko are incredibly strong cards, and owning one of them will be a massive boon to your mono fire teams. For their weapon assist, the biggest problem is the opportunity cost of not using their base form, which, as I mentioned, is a tremendously strong mono fire sub. But in this form here, you get Tape Resist, 3 Orb Enhances, and you still have a valuable active skill. You can have the full Cleric aspect of clearing Bind, Awoken Bind, and Unable to Match with Effects, along with the ability to have 50% damage reduction for 2 turns. So you might think, wow, I can do so many cool things with this, and you definitely can. At least one aspect of this weapon will be valuable, but one thing I want to mention is that in World of Carnage 2, especially the alt version, Tape Resist is not necessary, and you cannot double dip with his active skill, because Gil's attack when he's below 50% health is something you need to shield against, so yes, you need your shield, but then after that attack, he will Awoken Bind you and make lights unable to be matched. So you'll need to bring another solution for that as well. So you can't double dip, and that's unfortunate. Like, if this could solve all the problems, it'd be a stronger weapon assist, but it's not quite where we want it to be for that aspect. Still strong, but the opportunity cost of not using their base form is quite high. This TPA monster individual here has 4 effective skill boosts because they have a 2-turn delay and 2 skill boosts, and once they transform, 6,601 attack without any pluses, and 6 TPA awakenings. They're just going to deal spectacular amounts of TPA damage with a single 4 match, and the biggest hurdle is finding a truly viable place to utilize them on. At this point in time, mono light teams want to either make multiple combos, make an L, maybe blob slash rose of your Ferrule. Point of the matter is, TPA is not necessarily a pattern that is heavily pursued with like top tier teams. So it can be a little more awkward to incorporate them onto a given team because their damage output may be lackluster as well. In addition to that, their attacker typing does restrict them from certain type-based teams because it's only a single typing. Of course, you could argue that you could use them on Raijin Fasca teams, which can provide a meaningful home for themselves if you like Rainbow. If you want to use them as a leader, you have to remain above 50% health, which can be done, but you do need a healing solution because the damage reduction isn't that high. You only have 1 times RCV, and the attack multiplier is quite low. This attack multiplier can be offset by their naturally high personal damage, but it is still something that's going to be problematic for your other cards. And in terms of what latents to use on them, if used on a Rainbow-based team, they definitely can use the VDP latent because personal damage is through the roof, or they could utilize the unmatchable super latent because the unmatchable super latent scales from TPA awakenings, which means you can quickly remove them without an active skill. It's an interesting Like, it's an interesting aspect to it, but it has no value if lights are unmatchable, because you could match the light and therefore you can't trigger their thing. So it is something to keep in the back of your mind, but I feel like the biggest problem is there's no great home for them, because they should be strong. Their active skill is a two-turn cooldown that gives a buff to movement and attack. So wonderfully strong active skill. It just needs a good home to use them on, I feel like. If Light ever released a TPA-based leader that's strong, I feel like this individual here would definitely shoot up in viability overall. For their weapon assist, it provides two TPAs, which, again, is great for TPA-based teams, which are sadly not the most common at this point in time, but it is meaningful, and there are only three cards in North America that can provide the Is Awakening, so it is still something to keep in the back of your mind if you can't take advantage of their transforming state. And the active skill tied to this is quite strong. You get an attack buff, a movement time buff, and 100% damage reduction. And these buffs are significant amounts. It's four times attack buff, huge, and damage reduction to survive any hit as long as you don't get dispelled. So a meaningful active skill, but unfortunately the Awakenings don't have synergy with the vast majority of teams, and just using it for the active skill alone I think is not worthwhile, because if you don't take advantage of the TPAs, it's not that meaningful. The next is the Boar Helmet individual, and the Boar Helmet individual is going to be one of the most desirable cards in the entire event because of their weapon assist. In their base form, like, they do some cool stuff, but I feel like it's a reasonably generic card. You have a 13 turn damage and color absorb void for a single turn. Not terrible, but I feel like you definitely can do better, because wood is pretty stacked of great cards. For their evolved form, all their damage is centered on VDP, and if you don't have strong VDP solutions, maybe you could utilize them on a given team, but I still would not pass up on this weapon assist, because the weapon assist does so much for yourself overall. Because this weapon provides you with a skill boost, two team health, and two plus HP awakenings. So it adds, it helps teams transform more easily, which is great. It also provides a significant amount of added bulk. And this added bulk is tremendously helpful when you need to hit key health thresholds for difficult content. Right now, World of Carnage 2 has a pretty hard HP check of having 600,000 effective health. Because if you have 600,000 effective health, the ogres and gem floors become much easier by comparison. So this helmet can definitely facilitate that as well. But to top all of that off, it actually has a tremendously valuable active skill. This active skill provides you two turns of damage and color absorb void and two times attack for physical and attacker types. So a small attack buff, but the ability to overwrite color or damage absorb. That's huge, because at least one of those components will be needed in virtually any given dungeon. And the only true downside of this weapon is the fact that it's a 20-turn cooldown, which means it's going to be difficult to use on a repeated basis. For example, in World of Carnage 2, or World of Carnage 1, you could have potentially 3 color absorbs and 3 damage absorbs if things just go badly. So a 20-turn cooldown is not going to be sufficient for having it charged up on a regular basis as you need it. So you will have to definitely supplement this inherit with other solutions for those mechanics. But at the same time, if you're playing through World of Carnage 2, you really only need one instance of Color Absorb Void, and this active skill will beautifully provide that. You can stick that on top of, say, your shielding sub, because you don't need to use a shield until the gills floor. So you can use the Color Absorb and the Sharius, and then have the shield back up for gills. Beautiful weapon overall. It is my most desirable card for the 7 stars. The next 7-star card is this individual here, and in their base form, they actually have a very solid leader skill multipliers. Like, these are pretty good. You need to match 4 or more water orbs, 6 or more combos, and you have respectable leader skill overall. Like, these are nice numbers, easy to use. It's not going to outpace other options, and their own personal damage is only tied to VDP, which is definitely difficult, and their active skill, while being reasonable because it generates columns of water orbs, won't necessarily be a reliable cleric, because it only clears 5 turns of Awoken Binds. Certain dungeons, that should be okay, but many others, this will be insufficient. You'll have to rely on someone else. And with all these facts in mind, I would be more inclined to look at their other forms, because they provide more specific value. Like, it's more specialized. This is a reasonably general card, I feel like. It's a nice leader, but nothing special. Whereas their other forms are a bit more specialized by comparison. So, their evolved form trades the VDPs for 7 combos, which is much more reliable overall. They have super blinders. They even have a VDP as well. And they have a powerful leader skill that can be abused if you have four Sabitos, which are a 6-star card within this event, because their leader skill needs fixed 9 seconds of movement time, so you can't be time debuffed. And you also have sizable health and recovery multipliers, along with the fact that you get +6 combos when matching 4 or more connected water orbs. So I'm going to jump down to that 6-star card right now, because... Oh gosh, where is it? Here it is, because you need to understand what they do. Because with this 6-star card here, they are able to provide a 7-turn cooldown that gives you a column of hearts, a column of water orbs, and a single turn of haste. That means with 4 of them, you have a system where you can use one of their active skills every single turn. And in conjunction with your 7-star card here, you are able to have basically 8 combos from a swipe. Pretty outrageous. And if you inherit a follow-up attack somewhere on your team, because neither themselves or the subs actually have a follow-up attack, you can overcome resolve spawns, you overcome combo shields, you also do large amounts of damage, because 777 combo will trigger. The 77 combo on the system mobile card also works. So you have damage, you have the ability to overcome resolve spawns if you inherit a follow-up attack weapon assist, and it's mindless. The only big drawback is you need to have that follow-up attack weapon, and void spawns could be difficult because of the VDP not necessarily having enough orbs present from that system active skill. And another drawback is their active skill is a 15-turn cooldown, which can be problematic because it could be harder to inherit over top of it. And for the types of content you're probably going to be playing through, the spinner every turn is not necessarily going to be helpful, I feel. And with only 9 seconds of movement time, you can't really abuse it that well. And 100% damage reduction is probably not going to be necessary either. So if you can work around the longer base cooldown and you actually have a system, this card becomes stronger. But without the system, I feel like they definitely fall flatter. With that being said, if you don't have the system or no interest in the system, their weapon assist can be meaningful because it provides 4 orb enhances, which is a significant amount of passive damage. It also provides a full cleric option or cleric solution of bind, awoken bind, unable to match orb effects, and spawning a column of water orbs on either side. So lots of water orb generations, a cleric-based active skill, and passive damage. Wonderfully strong solution for mono water teams, and the only drawback is massive overlap with Goldfish Girl's weapon, because Goldfish Girl provides 3 team healths and the full cleric clear along with 99 turns of water skyfall. So if you need damage, pick this. If you need team health, pick Goldfish Girl, because team health will help you hit those health thresholds, which in turn lets you survive. Both are strong and both have different applications. Shinobu, in their base form, they feel relatively generic. They're very VDP oriented. VDP oriented is not a good thing nowadays, to be honest, because it's just hard to have that many dark orbs present every single turn. And you'd probably be better off taking a look at their evolved form. Because in their evolved form, they do have 4 skill boosts. They have 777 combo. They could have VDP or super poison resist through a super waking. So useful aspects there. But with a 4-turn cooldown, you can inherit a delay or haste to help people transform. So they become more effective skill boosts. Super poison resist is some utility. They do have respectable personal damage with that attack stat. So they're not a terrible thing. But at the same time, I feel like they're reasonably generic overall. Because they're not that magical. They don't necessarily solve mechanics on their own either. And if that's the case, their weapon assist probably will have more value because it provides 80% poison resist, which we do need to have, 1 team health awakening and a regular health awakening, so a bit of added bulk, and the active skill is a 2-turn delay, which can be effective skill boost if inherited on a card who can be charged up in time. You can use them as a way to fish out more skill boot or more stalling time to transform. That is definitely helpful, but it relies on the base card being charged up in time, and this aspect of the delay plus poison is not very strong beyond helping you transform, which means the card that it's inherited on top of needs to have a strong base skill in order to actually have value later on in a given dungeon. So it is definitely strong. It does have competition with the Samurai 3 weapons, but it gives bulk, which is something that might be difficult to incorporate on your team depending on what you're running. The next card is Akaza. I hope I'm saying that right, but They are a tremendously strong rainbow card. So, in their base form, they need 30 turns to transform, which is painfully long, to say the least, and they don't have any skill boosts either, so it's going to definitely be difficult to get them transformed in solo mode if you need them. But on the bright side, their leader skill is intact. They have the same amount of effective health, so you could potentially stall and tank for a couple of turns, but once you do transform, he becomes quite monstrous, because they have 5/7 combo awakenings, which translates into 32 times attack against any spawn, a tremendously high attack stat, and they can definitely utilize the VDP latent to great success because they'll be hitting so hard and they want to be used on rainbow teams. Also, when they do transform, their active skill becomes a 2-turn cooldown that creates 3 fire, water, wood, light, dark, and hard orbs over any orb. So, assuming there are no locked orbs, you have guaranteed rainbow activation. Every single turn. It's not just rainbow activation, it's VDP latent activation, so you can always pierce through void spawns, and their massive damage output is going to ensure that they do sufficient amounts, especially if you have two of them with dual leaders, let's say. Huge amounts of damage output. And as a leader, they are strong, assuming you can have devil type cards. You have the same bulk as Ryume, and we all know Ryume is one of the best leaders in the game. They have a reasonable amount of health, massive RCV, so they're always healed to full health, 75% damage reduction matching 4 or more colors, and auto follow attack, something Ryume didn't have. Furthermore, their active skill, once transformed, ensures they always can activate. They'll never be in danger of not activating, assuming they don't have locked orbs. And at the same time, if you do match 4 or more colors, you have damage reduction, and most boards have 4 or more orbs, even if they were locked to begin with, so it's a strong leader skill for sure once you do transform, but again, rainbow teams do suffer from having the ability not to concentrate damage as easily, and their ability to transform is quite difficult, especially in solo mode. Now, if all of this doesn't sound appealing, like you don't have a strong rainbow box, you don't want a pair of themselves, or say, like, the 8-star card as well, you do have the option of pursuing their incredibly powerful weapon assist. So this weapon assist has the most relevance for World of Carnage 2 because it provides 2 team health, which is more health, which helps you survive those health thresholds. It gives you a physical killer, which is incredibly strong because there are numerous tanky and dangerous physical spawns in the dungeon. And the 2 enhanced fire orbs can be useful because if not just for fire teams, because let's say you're playing with Nadeko. Nadeko converts fire to wood, so those enhanced orbs do play some value there. But on top of all those awakenings, the active skill is meaningful. It's a board unlock, changes the board to rainbow, which is okay because you can technically use other orb changes alongside of it if necessary to make a more favorable board, and also giving you 4 turns of 50% damage reduction. So you have the passive bulk to survive like ogres and gems, you have physical killer to kill the numerous physical spawns, you have passive damage, you also have an active skill that lets you survive Gilz' execute when below 50% health. I feel like this weapon assist was just made for World of Carnage 2, and if this is a dungeon you are playing through and struggling with, this weapon assist might be your dream come true because it provides value for so many different aspects in the dungeon. The last 7-star card is another Kanao. I hope I said that right. Jeez. And they provide 6 effective skill boosts due to their 2-turn delay. They also have respectable personal damage, and depending on the Super Awakening chosen, they can function on rainbow or monocolor teams. In addition to the delay, it also provides a column of hearts and 2 times orb movement time. So, I feel like this character is definitely much more front-end loaded because the delay is nice, but the active skill doesn't do that much overall. Later on in a dungeon, your 10-turn cooldown, the delay may not have an effect, and movement time buff for a 10-turn cooldown is not reliable when the dungeon may have multiple repeated movement time debuffs. So I feel like it's a little bit awkward in that sense because it's nice to get you going, but after you get going, she provides much less value moving forward. So it could be just a reasonable flexible sub, but kind of awkward overall. For their weapon assist, it provides a bit more universal value because it gives you full bind immunity, which can be meaningful. It also gives you a 3-turn delay. So a 3-turn delay can be effective skill boost. So assuming you have it inherited on a card whose active skill is short enough, you can delay the enemies for 3 turns, charge up, happier times all around. Of course, this does have overlap with Shelling Ford, who does provide 1 skill boost, which can be just more valuable compared to no skill boost. But at the same time, Shelling Four does have a 3-turn longer cooldown, so pros and cons there for sure. But the other aspect of this active skill is it's random what it does. It gives you a 3-turn delay and then either 3x RCV or 3x orb movement time. You can't rely on either one of those metrics because it's random. So I think that's kind of awkward. So again, it's a front-end loaded weapon assist. But again, if you enter a dungeon, you can use the inherit, and then if the base card has a strong active skill naturally, you never have to worry about using this inherit again. So it can help you transform, help you get going, and then hopefully you never have to use it again because it is unreliable. Now we come to the 6-star cards, and sadly, it becomes downhill from here. So Yushiro, in their base form, doesn't provide much. Like, Mono Wood is such a competitive color right now. There are so many strong solutions available. A bit of VDP damage does nothing. A bit of team health. It's just, like, Jurand is farmable and will surpass most wood cards anyways. So this card is something I feel like you can't really incorporate onto a team. As a weapon, maybe you can argue the 100% defense break has some value. Maybe for, like, say, training arena dungeons where the defenses are so high, breaking them can be helpful. Use it once, don't use it again. Maybe the tricolor boy changer has some aspects, but it's highly situational weapon overall. And with Hoppo being released, mono water teams don't have to worry about defense breaking anyways, because Hoppo solves that with the transformation, and the awakenings provided are really not that great. Tamiyo has numerous Recover Mind Awakenings, and normally that's kind of pointless, but it has the chance in very niche situations to be useful because they could potentially use the spinner counter super latent, because when you match that row of hearts, you can clear spinners, and you can clear 15 turns of spinners with a single row of hearts. Like, at this point in time, I don't think it's truly necessary to have, and especially the fact that you need to bring them as a sub on a team, and they don't provide any value outside of this unusual passive effect here. You have to run that super latent as well. Like, it's unusual. It's a very niche solution that I don't think we're going to necessarily need to have that often, or really, really at this point in time either. But it is unique. We can't necessarily do that with other cards. It's something to keep in the back of your mind, because there may be a dungeon in the future that has lots of spinners, and clearing them constantly might be meaningful if you don't have orb blocking solutions. The next is Sabito, who I did talk about beforehand, and their entire value hinges on the fact that you have at least 4 of them to create a system. Because with 4 of them, you can use an active skill every single turn to deal large amounts of damage. You can utilize them on, say, like Fujimi Naga plus Norza teams, or the 6-star card as well that I mentioned beforehand. Whichever team you choose to use them on, it creates fast farming solutions, like very mindless, swipeable, high damage, easy to play. Again, the value hinges on having a system. Without the system, they're a pretty generic card. With the system, definitely more valuable. So again, the value of this card, I feel, definitely hinges on what you value when playing through content. Next is an individual I can't pronounce. Red Face Mask. Red Pinocchio, I don't know. It looks like Pinocchio because of the long nose. Either way, this individual here has 500,000 true damage to all enemies. And a 500,000 button can be useful because spawns that have high defense, low health can be executed because of the true damage nature, always dealing that flat amount of damage. But at the same time, you can't increase this value. If you needed a bigger button, you can't use this card because it's not tied to the attack stat. So if you are button farming and that's something that's appealing to you, it's definitely going to be useful to have because it's a pretty big button with no extra animation time. So it definitely can be helpful if you're buttoning through certain content, and with a 10-turn cooldown, it's definitely usable. At the same time, if you don't button farm, this guy is kind of useless because that's all he's really good for. Next is Haga. I can't say this name. They have a 2-turn cooldown that creates 3 fire and wood orbs with an attack buff. It's actually a pretty decent active skill, but at the same time, I think it's difficult to truly incorporate onto a given team. All they provide is an L and 4 skill boost, really, in their active skill. Like, it's not terrible, but I don't think Grigory teams are really that great who could possibly be the best usage for this, maybe. I know my friend Melvin enjoys possibly using this for Trading Arena 2, but I think that needs a Tanjiro, which is just difficult to have anyway. So I feel like it's a really situational card, but maybe with the 2-turn cooldown, you might have some value, because 2-turn actives at least have a bit of flexibility overall. And then finally, we come to Enmu, who has respectable damage output against four different types, especially if they overlap. They also have a two-turn damage absorb counter. So two turns of damage absorb, as mentioned with the boar head weapon, is nice for certain content, but current content tends to favor multiple damage absorb spawns spaced out across the dungeon. So if a 20-turn cooldown, it's going to be difficult to charge up. The only truly, truly notable place to utilize this, I feel, is like AA3, where Machine Athena and Durga can appear back-to-back, 25% chance. Makes your life easier to have, but still kind of situational overall. And it definitely hinders the fact, because with a 20-turn cooldown, it's going to be difficult to work around. So again, if you don't have any other damage absorb solutions available or two turns, it might be something, but long cooldown, less relevant nowadays. So, do I plan to roll in my dream rolls? I do plan on rolling in the Demon Slayer collab, despite the poorly designed rare machine, because it offers new cards which could plug holes in my monster box, along with many of them being tremendously powerful and just having no other option to replicate otherwise. And for both of my accounts, I would love to roll M-U-Z-A-N. I don't want a chance saying that wrong, because they don't rely on other things in your box to truly succeed. They're just great on their own as a in their base form as a truly brainless leader that can excel at farming or ranking dungeons like fast, and doesn't require other things in your box to truly succeed. Whereas Tanjiro, I don't think it's necessarily going to advance either one of my monster boxes, because I already have Senna on Mantastic, and Tanjiro would be nice, but I do use Grandis, and it does work quite well. Like, it'd be it'd be an upgrade possibly, but at the same time, M-U-Z-A-N is just so unique in what it can do, it's hard to replicate. And then Fantastic has, like, no mono fire to support a firebox anyways. Maybe if I had Nezuko, Tanjiro could be useful for Fantastic, but not really gonna happen, I feel, overall. For the 7-star cards, the Boar Helmet is going to be my dream card for both accounts, because again, universal value is exceptionally high. Skill boost, team health, bonus health, helps you survive, helps you charge up, and a highly relevant active skill. Like, there's no real losing with this weapon assist, and I feel like with this weapon assist, it has tremendous staying power moving forward, because weapons tend to stay relevant longer compared to leaders or subs, just because it's kind of hard to outpace a weapon sometimes, especially one like the Boar Helmet, which is so overtuned overall. And then finally, for the 6-star cards, I want more of the systemable ones, because like, I'm probably going to get them anyways, but if I had to get multiple duplicates, I'll pick him, because Sabito has the ability to make a system, and I do have Norza's, so I could possibly make something out of it anyways. So, in conclusion, the Demon Slayer collab does feature numerous powerful cards overall, but it is a terribly top-heavy affair. The only good cards are really the 7 and 8 star, and the bottom rarity, I feel like the vast majority of them are just not that magical, aside from Sabito, who could be a system, but again, it's only valuable if you make the system. So, in addition to that, you do have the terribly designed rare machine where you cannot monster exchange for the 7-star cards. You have to roll them, and if the Monogatari collab, where you try to chase Nadeko in vain, was any indication of what it's like, it's going to be a painful experience overall. But with that being said, let me know what you think about this event in the comments below, along with what your dream rolls are and if they actually came true. Either way, hopefully all a fantastic day. I wish you all the best luck in your own pad adventures, and happy puzzling.